Hello everyone, we're getting ready to look up today with a brand new Uplook video discussing one of our top 10 lists. You can like the video, subscribe, and ring the bell to make sure you don't miss any of our future videos. Today's topic, 10 ways to encourage your fellow believers. It's pretty hard to overdose on true spiritual encouragement. With so much around to discourage us, thank God for those people who take His command seriously to encourage one another daily, Hebrews 3:13. But with the world getting darker, we need more of it. So let's look at some practical ways to lift the spirits of the saints. Here we go with number one. By your own example.
I think we can recognize the God of all encouragement is our personal friend. And so we ought to be encouraged ourselves. We don't want to be like the toothpaste salesman who has bad breath, right? If we're telling people Christ brings joy, we ought to manifest that. And it's important not to give an evil report of the land like the 10 spies. We all have influenza. That's just the Italian word for influence. And so we affect other people, and I'd hate to be the kind of guy that brightens up a room by leaving it. So let's be positive and let's look for things that will encourage. Anybody can see the dark things, but to look for the light, look for that morning star, the bright things of life, and to accentuate them is really helpful to God's people.
Good. And number two, by letting them know what you appreciate about them.
Don't wait to say good things until somebody's funeral. Do it while it will encourage them and do some good. I think very often we just overlook the simplest little things. To tell somebody, I appreciate the fact that you are an overcomer. You've been through such hard things, but you keep sailing on through the storm. Or I notice how you care about your wife or how you love your kids. I notice how faithful you are. I notice how you pick up other people's trash or straighten things when it's not your job. You're a great example to me. Every time I think of you, I thank God for you. Or we've known each other for 30 years, and all I can think of are happy memories. These are good things to say to God's people, and they're very heartening to them.
And number three, by sending an anonymous note or card.
Sometimes if we know people well, they hear encouraging words from us, but it's good to sort of stand back and speak anonymously sometimes. Maybe a little note that says, I notice you take out the trash at our local church, and I think the Lord notices that too. Thanks for what you're doing. But we have lots of ways to communicate with people today through texts and emails and phone calls and visits. Let's use these for the glory of God and for the encouragement of one another.
And number four, by taking them along on a ministry opportunity.
One of the things that really helped me in my early Christian life was people like Ed Harlow, who ran Everyday Publications, giving me the opportunity of designing a book cover. Up till that time, I'd been given little token jobs, and so it was just kind of a little lope. But when all of a sudden people like Bill Pell, when I was just a teenager, said, how would you like to write a Sunday school paper for me that I'm going to publish? Like, that turned it into a headlong race for the finish line. And I think sometimes we don't realize that allowing people to fail a little bit with a safety net there, the Lord Jesus did that with His disciples. And if we give young people or young believers a little opportunity to have an investment, not simply to be receivers all the time, but to actually invest. Maybe go over and clean an elder's yard in the spring or help a widow. And all of a sudden, instead of them thinking of the local church as they begin to think about it as we. And that's a huge mind change when we have an investment in the work, and therefore we feel that we have some value to the saints that gather there.
And number five, by being willing to spend time listening.
That's kind of a tough one for me, but I've got to learn to do it better. There are certain people And they have a lot of words stored up because they don't get a lot of opportunity to share with people. Lonely singles, or widows, or shut-ins, or sometimes there's some sort of exotic people that people avoid talking to because they have a different way of thinking. And so they just have these pent-up words. And to let them talk is one of the best things we can do for them, to listen and take them seriously and care what they care about. We do this with our own children. I don't particularly care about playing with dolls, but when my grandchildren come, all of a sudden dolls become greatly interesting to me. And I think if we can realize that with people, maybe I'm not interested in gardening or whatever it might be, but if somebody else is and I can show an interest in what they're doing, it's hugely encouraging to them. They feel like they're being taken seriously.
And number six, by telling them special ways the Lord has used others like them.
I think if we can start to see certain characteristics in them, to say to someone like, you remind me of Robert Chapman. He was the apostle of love. Here was a wealthy man who gave up everything for the cause of Christ and would actually pick up the shoes of his guests and shine them in the morning. The first time he came into Barnstable, he was riding in a coach and four with the liverymen. And the next time he walked into town and he humbled himself. He condescended to men of low estate. And I see that in you. Your willingness, though you're a very intelligent person, you're willing to talk to the little children and to simple believers. And three cheers for that. So if we know Bible characters, or we know characters in church history, and we can link these people, you remind me of this person, it's hugely encouraging to them to feel that they're part of the mainstream of Christian life and testimony.
And number seven, by sharing an inspiring story, a good book, a good place to visit, a favorite restaurant, etc.
Right, just little windows into our lives, letting them in, giving them access to our world and saying, hey, here's a book that really encouraged me. See if it's your style and try to learn, because not everybody enjoys every kind of book. But to say, here's a book that I found really helpful, and tell me what you think. Or here's one of my favorite verses. What's one of your favorite verses? And by doing this, we can encourage fellowship with one another. So sometimes just giving them a little more access to me and say, I love to do this on an afternoon, a nice sunny afternoon. How'd you like to come along? Just giving them access. This is what Jesus did with his disciples. He gave them access. He let them see him praying to his Father, to hear the conversation. What a powerful thing that is. So giving people access to our lives, letting them in a little deeper into some of our little enjoyments is something that is greatly encouraging to people.
And right along with that, number eight, by asking them their favorite verse, hymn, or experience.
Right, not just telling mine, but doing a little mining myself and say, hey, tell me, is there a verse that the Lord has blessed you with recently, or an experience you've had with the Lord that's been encouraging? Sometimes I'll go into a local church and there are all sorts of exciting things happening, but nobody in that local church knows. And so I'll say to them, like, know anything encouraging happening? Had any good opportunities to witness lately? And then I'll get up on the platform and tell the Christians about good things that are happening in their local church and they don't even know it. And it's just a matter of asking. People say, how do you have all these good stories? Well, I just ask people. And if you ask enough people, you're going to find out there are lots of good things happening that people don't share. There's no venue for that sometimes in the life of the local church. And we need to hear those things because they're hugely encouraging.
Number nine, by letting them know you pray for them. I know personally this is something that's very encouraging when I'll get a text saying, I'm praying for you.
I remember coming up the stairs in Chicago in a church building there, and there was an elderly gentleman there, and I went up to him and I introduced myself, Mr. Heidman, Jabe Nicholson. And he said, oh, I know you. I pray for you every day. And once in a while, I get a text on my phone, and it simply says, from a friend up in the mountains of West Virginia, I prayed for you just now. Wow, that is so exciting, so encouraging, especially if you're going through a hard time and you know the Spirit of God has touched them to intercede for you. So this is really thrilling stuff. And we not only pray for them, but pray with them. I think to be instant in prayer, when somebody says, "Would you pray about this?" and we say, "Yes, we'll pray about it," instead of, "Okay, when's a good time to pray about it?" Let's do it right now. And again, it is very encouraging to do that.
And then finally, number 10, by assuming their coming to mind is not a brain misfire.
Right. If I'm driving along in the car or looking at my computer and all of a sudden somebody comes to mind, I shouldn't assume that these are synapses misfiring, that actually the Spirit of God is touching me to touch them, because we are the body of Christ. And if we need to scratch where it itches, we need to be sensitive to the head and how the head uses us. One time I was sitting at the computer early in the morning, the wee hours of the morning, and I thought of a certain lady. I knew she was in a very unhappy marriage situation. Her husband was quite offensive and didn't really care for her. And so I prayed for her. Well, this happened 3 nights in a row, and I thought, I better contact this lady. And so I contacted a friend who was a walking buddy of hers, and in a few minutes the phone rang and it was her. And she said, "What is it, Jabe?" And I said, "I don't really know." She said, "Well, didn't you initiate the call?" I said, "Yes." But she said, "Well, then what is it?" I said, "I don't know. It's just that the last 3 nights, God has been reminding me of you and I've been praying for you." And she started to cry. And she said, "3 nights ago, I was lying in bed. And I thought to myself, I don't think anybody thinks about me anymore." And, I said, "Well, it's not me. It's the greatest mind in the universe, the greatest heart in the universe. He's thinking about you." And he communicated that to me so I could use my phone, because he doesn't have one, to let you know that you're still being thought about. Well, this is so crucial, Christians. We have it in our hands to lift people up, to help them over the bumps, to shine through the clouds, to give them memories of happy occasions in the past, of the Lord's blessing. Just a little, "Hey, I remember years ago when you spoke and God spoke to me through you." Do you realize what that does for people? God, help us to use these mouths, these tongues, these words that we have to transform, to encourage and help other people. We can do it every day. Let's do it. Encourage one another daily.